Welcome to Collaborative Crafting Part 3, Assemble an Army of Evidence. As Carl Sagan once stated, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. And so today we're going to be focusing on how we get students to use evidence and to find the best evidence in the writing. This fits into our MTSS framework with evidence-based instructional priorities, and it hits every single one of them. It's a guided instruction with students where feedback is happening. We're following the instructional hierarchy, systematic vocabulary, classroom discussion. This has it all. According to the secondary writing framework, we're sitting here in number 5, the fifth pillar, which is to teach critical skills, processes, and knowledge. And really, this is about process writing and the use of process writing coupled with gradual release to build that student efficacy when it comes to how they feel about their ability to write. We have Stephanie Nasser.
Hi.
And we have Michelle Hall.
Hello.
Last time we spent some time going over how to get kids to focus on their writing, and now we're looking at evidence. So how do we basically get students to use the best evidence? I know a lot of times evidence might not align to their point, or they'll just grab anything and put it in there. And so sometimes it's important to be explicit in how we teach them to analyze and evaluate whether or not that evidence is the best evidence. Just to start, can you describe your approach to teaching middle school students how to use evidence in the writing?
My approach is to do it as we go. It is to not have that be the stumbling block or the frustration during the writing process. So we are very, if you will, overly stating how they take notes while we read, writing down specific evidence with page numbers. That's step one. Step two for having good evidence would be while we brainstorm, we write it down again. So when they go to actually write the essay, they have it right there and they're literally just copying it from their notes. We emphasize the paraphrasing of that evidence as, again, during the note-taking and the brainstorming, because, again, we don't want the frustration of them having to figure out how to paraphrase a quote when they get to the writing process. That's step one. Step two, learning what good evidence is, making sure they understand that evidence is supporting the thesis or the claim of the essay. And it's a constant back and forth of questioning to them and then them answering the question. There's never a wrong answer if they can back it up with their reasoning. So next time we are going to discuss elaboration, but it's important to know that those two things go hand in hand. You cannot have good evidence without having good elaboration, and you can't elaborate if you don't have good evidence. And the evidence needs to be very specific. Right? It can't be vague. So when they go to paraphrase it, they literally, like, there's many times in earlier in the year, like September, October, where you're spending a lot of time making sure that evidence speaks directly to the text. It doesn't matter if it's a book or an article or a short story or whatever, it needs to go back to that because that's backing up their reasoning and their thesis.
And one thing that you do, Stephanie, that you didn't mention is you mentioned they write in their comp books, the pieces of evidence, but you have them highlight while they're reading. You're like, yes, highlight that. That supports this. Mm-hmm. That supports that argument. So you teach them that skill, highlight, pull things out, and then I'm going to put it in my comp book.
So they now have interacted with the material 3 times before they go to write the essay. The essay needs to be a non-frustrating event. Right? And it needs to almost be organic, if you will, the process mm-hmm. of that writing. So good evidence, if we can tackle that learning, that skill, that modality before we get there, a lot of times the kids will come up and say, what page is such and such on? And the answer at the beginning of the year was, let me help you find that. The right. answer now is, okay, I don't know where it is. You tell me where it is. And they'll be like, oh, I should go look at my notes, or, oh, I should go find the page tabs that are pink for this character, right? So we're at that point where we're shedding, we're letting go, we're getting them more autonomous, right? Because we've given them the skills to build upon that. This part of the puzzle, the writing puzzle, if you will, it's simple.
That leads me to another question that I have, or that I've wrote down here. But you were saying earlier in the year, you've already hit sort of what evidence is. So now they're having the repetition. So then earlier in the year, or any time of the year, do you provide feedback on their actual use of evidence itself? And if so, what types of feedback do you find most effective in helping them to improve?
Okay,
like, do you ever pull that out, the evidence, and go, okay, this is good, but this is great, and here's why.
Right. So let's say, for example, the feedback comes in multiple ways. One, the feedback, the most obvious way is when we edit the essay, right?
Right.
That because, and although that is the step, the last step before they submit it as a best draft, we don't like to say final, right? Best draft. Mm-hmm. That's so late in the process, but sometimes that's where it has to wait. The step before that would be they'll give me a piece of evidence and I'll put it on the board and I'll be like, this is really good. But if I'm looking at this, at what you decided that you're going to sell me, argue about, you know, discuss,
mm-hmm.
do you think there could be another thing that this character did or this character said that shows XYZ? And all of a sudden it's like, oh, I remember he did that. Or other kids will be like, I know. The other way we give feedback is we will have the kids in their tables with their small groups talk to each other. And I'll pose a question. I'll be like, so we just read this. And it says that, you know, that the character did something, acted with whatever. Can you find me a piece of evidence anywhere on this page that supports their attitude, their behavior, their mind, the character's mindset? And then what happens is they will actually naturally come up with different answers.
Mm-hmm.
But there'll be commonalities throughout the room. And then they could be like, I said this because, and I'll be like, write that down, because now you just gave me evidence and the reason behind it. And it now, because we've done it so often, it's automatic. And so that way we interact with the essay from the minute we start reading. It's always like, tell them, these notes are going to be for essay 6 or essay 7. So we're going to work on these right now. And now we're at the stage where kids are highlighting their own notes before I have to say anything. Like mm-hmm. those cop books become, if you will, very precious, and how they take care of them, because they realize everything is in there.
Stephanie, you touched on this, but one of the things that I see you do a lot is you don't tell the students things, you always question them. So you're like, where in the text does it show that character has a sense of guilt? Find it. And like you said, 36 kids are looking, sharing, and the ones who don't know are listening to their peers.
Right.
And I've noticed that if one's not strong, you're like, you question more. You just have them delve deeper and deeper. You're very skilled at questioning.
Thank you.
To guide them where you want to go.
You know, it's funny because they'll be like, I think this, and that's usually the kid, like you said, Michelle, that's winging it, right? They're winging their answer, because in this room, I don't know is unacceptable. You cannot, when you have a kid that literally says, I don't know, I'll say, okay, we'll wait for you to find it.
One, dialogue is key. Everyone's talking, which we know is really strong.
Yes,
and then the other thing is that students are always returning to their notes. I know a lot of times, and I experience this too, is like, you know, I'll take notes and then I never look at them again.
Right.
But what you're saying is you create this book and then it's sort of the composition book and it's a constant returning to the notes.
It's a constant. Go back to your character page. Go back to your character page. Where did you have this on the character page? Where did you have it on the page marked guilt? And then they flip back and then they're like, oh, I got it. And a lot of times it's like, okay, don't call out, you know, give so-and-so another chair. But I don't also want to quell the excitement of them being able to know that where they are today, February, whatever, to where they have been, right, mm-hmm. back in September. You know what I mean? Because the progress, they see the progress. So we're coming up to like parateacher conferences, and a big thing that we do with them is have them pull up their second essay and have them pull up their ninth essay and look at them side by side and write down three things that they feel really good about that they are now stronger. Mm-hmm. And they'll look at that second essay and be like, oh my gosh, Ms. Nassar, I can't believe I wrote that. Or I can't believe how many dead words I used. Or, oh my God. Like, and it's a huge thing. And then on the other side, we have them write down, what three things do you think you still want to work on? So then when we get to essay 10, 11, whatever, at the top of their essay, they're going to say, I'm still working on, and fill it, write it down. Because then I look, that's what I will focus in on, you know, for grading at this time of the year, right? Which A, makes it faster for me to grade because I'm not reading the whole thing. But B, mm-hmm. I'm honing in on what they want to improve before we get to the end of the year.
I love the goal setting aspect of that too, that they're owning their own goal setting. I want to bring it back just kind of to get explicit on the evidence part, but I want to start by just watching a clip of you teaching evidence with your students.
Who shot who? A random soldier. Yes? What's her name? Could you find me a specific example that shows that she is having, like, she feels guilty about what she just did? All right, Amelia, go. She stood what? Okay, and we are on page 70, right? And this is Amelia. She stood cemented in shock. And why is this a good example of her feeling guilty? Okay, one reason could be that she shot a German soldier and he wasn't Russian. Amelia? For sure. Amelia has never killed anybody. She has never killed anyone. That is an excellent example.
Just kind of walk me through what's happening on the board.
The notes is that they have this T-chart in their notebook. We use the same structure of note-taking all year. It does not change. So a character chart that we build for characters is the same one all year. This one is for the emotions that the characters are feeling that come up from page one that go all the way to the end and how they deal with this emotion to get through. So again, it does not change. This unit is 7 weeks long. Yeah, 7-8 weeks long, something like that. And so this chart, we would build it day one. When they fill it with evidence and they don't have room, they like, we'll make another one. I don't even have to tell them to do that. It's automatic because because we've trained them so hard in the beginning of the year. It just go. And so the structure doesn't change. So they don't have to learn different ways to take notes throughout the year. There's only one, we only use two things. And once they know them, it's just done. So now because we're later in the year, we're on our fourth unit, it's like, okay, I need you to build character notes for four characters. And they just go. They just do it. If they don't remember, they go back to the beginning of their comp book where they have, like, if you will, a scaffold that they did not fill in that just tells them everything that they have.
Another thing that she does, like the kids use the, she teaches them how to create a graphic organizer. She doesn't just give them a graphic organizer. So if I'm going to sit down and write, I'm going to be like, okay, I should probably format this somehow with pros and cons or character traits or whatever. And then I especially geek out when she has them color code things. So like if the pros are in pink and the cons are in yellow, and then I'll do that with their readings and the comp books. So that's a scaffold as well as color coding, which I love.
It's so fun. And, you know, this time of year, I'm like, you can choose your color. Just make sure you're going to choose an opposite color for, you know, we're in the middle of argument essay writing right now. And, you know, so it's like, choose, you know, for your side, choose a color. And when you go to the other side, choose a different color. And they're like, I can choose my own color. They get super excited. I think I'm the most tired in September because the training is happening constantly.
One of the big takeaways that I've seen, and I think it's worth pointing out, is that this is called assemble an army of evidence because that's what's happening. They are curating as much evidence as possible then before they actually choose which one they're going to use. And going into that, let me go into this next clip where we actually get to see some of the color coding. And Michelle, get ready to geek out.
Help. From all
There you go, Michelle.
Second, health benefits, your second color, is going to be for highlighting every environmental and or economic benefit for the diet you chose.
Gives me goosebumps.
Do you want the children to have options? I'm like, in the morning, you know, when you get dressed, y'all tend to just put on the same thing you wore yesterday. That's a different conversation. But let's suppose you had, you know, 20 things and you got to choose. It makes your writing less limited. It makes your thinking more open. It creates so many options for them.
I've seen students question you, like, well, come to your desk, and they're like, can I put this? And you're like, can you support it? And they're like, yeah. And then you're like, then go ahead. They're asking your permission.
Yeah. And when we do writer's workshop and I have the kids, we're all sitting at a table and we're doing it together. And one student will say, can I use this? And another student, can I use what she said? I'm like, you can use the same piece of evidence that she said if you think it's better than the one that you chose. They're like, oh yeah, can I switch my, huh? Because we're all reading the same book or the same text or the same article.
Let me go to this screen real quick. And there's no video on this. It's just a still shot of, it looks like a full day's brainstorm.
Yeah.
Can you just kind of highlight some of the parts of this with how you talk kids through the evidence here?
We always start in the middle on a chart, because once we have that chart done, the rest of the essay, the intro, the body, it fills itself out by itself, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. I will talk them through and be like, okay, I am going to put down in the two colors, like, you know, and I put a dot next to the body paragraph so they know that red goes to health and body two goes to environmental and economy. So then they can see what I'm putting down. They're telling me what to put down. I am not writing this down. They are telling me and I'm doing it as they're telling me, you know, in red and blue. Then they go back based on these notes and they'll find the evidence from here. The reason we do it this way for this particular essay is this particular essay is teaching them how to write argument. There's going to be a wide variety of sources that the students have used. So they're going to have to find their evidence because it's going to be different from the person next to them. Right. So it's kind of going backwards, but it's equally as effective in how they go about knowing what's what and where it goes because of the color coding. Obviously, they would write down everything in one color, pencil, pen, whatever, but that's when they would go back and I would say, okay, before we move on, I want you to pick a color for body one. What color is that? A yellow. Okay, so highlight everything in yellow that goes to health and label it health.
You give them multiple articles, like you said, like in that video, there were six they could choose from. So yeah, you give them that structure and then, okay, on your own, find your evidence from whatever articles you chose.
And they've already highlighted and annotated those articles. So it's not like they have to reread it. They're just picking it out, you know, or flipping to a different page in their comp book where they have their notes from the articles.
In this conversation, if we were to distill this down, say, into two tips when it comes to teaching students about evidence, what would you say are the two biggest things? Let's say I'm a brand new teacher, or I'm a teacher who's struggled to teach writing. What are the two things that I would keep top of mind when it comes to teaching students about evidence?
Tip number one is having them interact with that evidence at multiple steps, right? We read it, we mark it, we brainstorm, we write it down, we highlight it, and then we go to use it. So I think the more they interact with whatever piece of evidence that they're using, I think that the more they interact with it, the stronger that evidence will be. That's number one. The second tip would be that don't get caught up that they have to give the evidence that's in your head. It's so important for students to have their voice. And I know that I've talked about this before, but if they think that, you know, the evidence that John plays ball is that John carries a ball in his backpack, and you're like, ooh, that's not really what I was. Now you got to let it go. You got to let it go. So I think that's my second tip. Is my first one is let them interact with the evidence as much as possible before you get to writing. And my second one would be let them own the evidence that they choose.
So I'm going to do number three. Yeah. Scott, you mentioned it. Make it dialogical, like have a dialogue about it. Teacher questions. Like Stephanie doesn't just model or think aloud. She questions. She's not showing them her thinking. She's making them do the thinking. And like, this is how it's done. But they talk to Stephanie, they talk to their partners, to their groups, but they dialogue that text for it to make sense.
I want to add a fourth real quick. And I think this encompasses the dialogue, the honoring their choice in a target of correctness. And then I think also the interacting. And it goes back again to the having a plethora of pieces of evidence. So inherently they're having to evaluate. If they've got 10 and they can only choose one, they're having to evaluate versus going in and saying, just looking for one. Thanks for joining us today. And we will have next week on the 7th, we will be talking about elaboration. And where Stephanie is going to share some of the questioning strategies that she uses with her students. Each week, we're going to provide student samples from footage, a live discussion like the one we just had, teacher footage, resources used during filming, as well as any other resources that we can. Feel free to join the conversation if you'd like to be a part of this and share how you do elaboration. You can leave feedback or email myself, Michelle, or Stephanie, and we'd be happy to collaborate with you. And as always, important things to remember, there's Canyon's U, there's a bite-sized PD page, and you can get relicensure credit by doing these.